Hi, my name is Antonis and I am the iconographer of this video. For today, you will see me painting the holy face of Saint Porfyrios, a contemporary saint of the Orthodox Church, and you will see me depicting the holy face of him using the Cretan tradition of iconography. As you see, I have already started my painting by having transferred my drawing on the board, and now I am doing the underpainting, that is, I am painting with pure black his facial characteristics. Now you will notice that I will not paint Saint Porfyrios in the style of photorealism or a very naturalistic style. I will paint him. I will use the photographs of Saint Porfyrios to and I will translate these photographs into the Byzantine tradition, the Byzantine style. So this icon is not for the iconographers who aspire to learn how to paint Saint Porfyrios in a naturalistic style. Rather, it's more for those who are interested in learning how to convey the actual facial characteristics of a human person into the conventions of the Byzantine painting. So, as you see here, I am taking some time to understand where the shadows will be beneath the proplasmos and what the shapes of the lights on his cheeks will be. Now, after I've done this very basic underpainting, I will start by filling the holy face of Saint Porfyrios with this green-brownish proplasmo. This is the same proplasmos that I've seen to be used in very old icons of the Cretan tradition. And it consists of yellow ochre, white, and a little bit of white, some black, and a tiny little bit of cadmium yellow. I don't really mind if this proplasmos is a little bit transparent. It's okay to me. And as you see now, I will start painting the facial characteristics with a darker color. It's one or two tones darker than my proplasmos, and it's also a little bit warmer. So for this grapsimata, as it's called, step, I will take some of the color of my proplasmos, I will add a little bit of black and just a tiny little bit of iron oxide red. I will take my time to draw this grapsimata in a way that is not very dark or very distinctive. I want them to be elegant as much as I can, and just a few tones darker. Now, when I started drawing Saint Porfyrios, I have to say that this icon is a commission by an amazing commissioner of mine that lives in Belgium, and I want to really thank this commissioner of mine for giving me the chance to paint Saint Porfyrios, And he insisted in painting Saint Porfyrios in the Cretan tradition, in the Cretan style. He was educated enough in iconography to understand that it is not part of the dogma, of the Orthodox dogma, to paint a saint realistically, naturalistically, in the way his earthly characteristics were. Again, my English is a little bit on the way, but it's okay. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. So I want to make clear this to many iconographers who paint icons that are to be part of the church life, that we really cannot paint a saint with his earthly characteristics. We should pay attention to that. It's not part of the Orthodox dogma. And even if the saint is a contemporary saint, that doesn't justify iconographers to paint him the way he was. He appeared in photographs and the way we saw him in videos and other mediums. So please take that into consideration, that you should use his characteristics. We should advise ourselves before we make the drawing of a saint about his earthly characteristics, but then we should translate those into the Byzantine style. For this drawing of Saint Porfyrios, I saw many photographs of him, and I tried to understand how I could translate this his face into an icon. It is it's really hard, and it's a challenge for an iconographer. Exactly, because we all like to paint a saint with some making him look a little bit like the way he was in real life. But even if you don't achieve this, that's really okay. If you make, for example, Saint Porfyrios or Saint Paisios in the Byzantine style, and the saint doesn't really look at all like Saint Porfyrios, the way he appeared in the photographs, that's, in my opinion, really fine. That is better than creating an icon of a contemporary saint that looks like his photographs. But anyway, here, before I started painting this commission, I realized that I had to look not into other contemporary paintings, the way other iconographers had painted Saint Porfyrios, but just look directly to the photos of him and make a drawing first that resembled like him, but also kept the style of the Byzantine painting. So while I'm painting now the photismata, the first light on the proplasmo, on the base color of Saint Porfyrios, I try to look some photographs of Saint Porfyrios and try to imagine how these photographs can be translated into the Byzantine style. Again, I'm using the same technique. I have created this color by mixing titanium white, some ochre yellow, and some red, some cadmium red, And with this, I will just pass a first layer of light. As you see here, I'm painting with that same color the white of the eyes, the lighted part of the eyes. That is not the correct way to do it, but at that point I just wanted to see if I could I wanted to have a sense of how Saint Porfyrios would look with the light in the eyes. Sometimes when we add that light right next to the iris, the whole expression, the whole gaze of the face of a saint changes. And I just wanted to have a general idea of how this little light would inform my the portrait of Saint Porfyrios. So a big part of an icon resembling to the saint is to, when you draw the saint, to keep in mind the shape of his beard, the shape of his mustache, and just try to see the general shape of his or her head, and how this can be painted in the Byzantine style. In my opinion, this is very feasible, and every kind of human face, a human head, can be painted in the Byzantine style, idealized the way that the Byzantine painting idealizes stylizes the forms, and at the same time keep some of the resemblance of the person we depict. Now at this point I have finished with painting my first light, and as you see here, I have prepared a medium color to blend this first light with my proplasma, using a very linear way. I will try to blend this first light with my proplasma. At this point, I have to say that the saint I'm painting looked more like Saint Nectarios, as many of you iconographers will agree. But I just kept painting, and felt that at some point the face will start resembling Saint Porfyrios. I was thinking to myself that even if this icon will not really resemble Saint Paisios, I'm okay. Saint Porfyrios, I'm okay with that, as long as I will present my commissioner an icon that is faithful to the Cretan tradition, as he requested, and it will not be painted in the photonaturalistic style that many iconographers paint. I have to say that I was very pleasantly surprised by my commissioner, because I don't believe he was of Greek origin. But he insisted in using the most, let's say, extreme of the Cretan style, the hardcore, let's say, Cretan style, and paint an icon that really resembles the work of Agelos Akotandos and other iconographers of Crete. So again, thank you so much for commissioning this icon to me, Ioanni. I hope that this was of your liking, and thank you so much for giving me the chance to get more in touch with this amazing saint that Saint Porfyrios is. It's true that sometimes iconographers feel more in touch to some saints than others, and although we respect all and we pray to all, it's true that some saints are touching us deeper, and we can feel their presence in a way that is amazing. Just try to be open. I know that many iconographers are not very, let's say, faithful, me included. We respect the tradition, we respect the painting art, but who can tell who is faithful and who isn't? Anyway, that's a big discussion. I know that some iconographers live a very secular way of life, and that's, I would say, it's okay during these days that we live. I just tried to be. I tried to be open while painting Saint Porfyrios, and I wondered myself how Saint Porfyrios could touch me, could present himself in me while painting this icon, and I have to say that I will just say maybe that Saint Porfyrios is an alive saint, and he presented himself in a very subtle but deep for me way. Anyway, here you see me painting the a second blending tone, a tone that is closer to the first photosma. And with this, I will try to blend even better the lights on the face of Saint Porfyrios. Again, as you see, my brush stroke is not smooth. It's very linear. I have to say that this head is small enough. If you compare the head to my hand holding the brush, you will understand that the face of Saint Porfyrios here is much small. So I really enjoy painting with these lines, and although I see many iconographers painting, me included, sometimes in a very smooth and very ironed, let's say, way. Sometimes I truly enjoy painting in this sloppy or linear way. It's part of the Cretan post-Byzantine tradition, not post-modern, post-Byzantine tradition, and in my opinion, it gives the icon a very nice painterly value. Again, as I paint, I consult photographs of Saint Porfyrios, and I loosely try to make my icon resemble a little bit with him, without following any of the naturalistic tricks to paint the face. I've seen many iconographers in order, I don't know why, because it just is very confusing. They add some reflections in the iris, right next to the pupil. I don't know what this is about. It's really not in the in the tradition of the Byzantine style, and it really is, does nothing. It's as if you paint with one leg here and one leg there. I mean, just choose, if you want to paint in a naturalistic way, just paint in a naturalistic way. Don't try to mix those two in a way that is very pompous somehow, because the result will be something of not good taste. Many beginner iconographers usually do this. I haven't seen, but rarely accomplished iconographers fall into these, let's say, traps. But to me, it's always something unpleasant to see an icon with where part of the saint is painted naturalistically. This is, I guess, the worst of all. Like, if you paint a saint, just choose a style and paint the whole saint in one same style. Again, if you choose to paint a saint in a naturalistic way, a photorealistic way sometimes, make a portrait of a saint, then please do not offer this icon to a church, as it shouldn't be part of the services and the prayer that people should give to. The icon should be the gate from where we should think of the person that is depicted, and not the same person. We shouldn't pray on specifically on an icon, believing that this icon, for example, is Saint Porfyrios. No, it's not Saint Porfyrios, but the icon should help us to think of Saint Porfyrios in a non-obtrusive and distracting way. And again, an icon that is to be part of the church life, part of the services in church, should not be painted in a very naturalistic way. I know that I might repeat too much myself, but it's something very important, and the church itself should take a stance and should stop receiving icons painted that way. So, yeah. Now, at this point, you still see me painting the first light of on the face of Saint Porfyrios, and I've done my blending from the first light to my proplasmo, and at this point, you just see me re-establishing the shapes of the first light by painting in this linear way, with a very light and transparent first light. Again, at this point, it doesn't the face doesn't really look like Saint Porfyrios, but I'm fine with that. I had talked already with my commissioner, and I was confident that we didn't have any such issues. So I felt free to proceed and see if I could further make Saint Porfyrios look a little bit like his earthly characteristics. I have to say that Cretan style, Cretan post-Byzantine tradition, although it seems dry, it seems not painterly, I'm pretty sure that the masters of the Cretan style were great painters, and they knew how to paint, and their painting is not dry at all. The final result might look very confined and very strict, but these painters knew how to use a brush, and their work was not following steps like step one, step two, and that's it. They did use their artistic intelligence, they used their their gift to improve iconography, and they just followed the ancient tradition of painting. I've heard lately that from some viewers of mine that there are some iconographic styles that are very strict, and in the way they are following the painting process, and it's considered almost a dogmatic failure to change these the process and to not follow the process. Now, I don't mean that we should experiment with the forms. This is to me very clear that the forms and the stylization, let's say, of the Byzantine painting is there, and we should follow that. But the process, it's something alive, something that should be alive, and we are not robots. Some styles, for example, believe that we should always glaze everything, use a lot of glazes, and if you don't build the face of a saint using glazes, then this is a mistake. This is almost a dogmatic mistake, because and there they use some strange crazy link, crazy connection to icon painting with the dogma. No, things are more simple, and the iconographer should be more free. We should just remember that an icon is the way, the medium to bring our mind into heavens, and not to obstruct the mind, and that's our goal as iconographers. Now, if you achieve this goal by using glazes, or you don't use glazes, or anything like that, this is something else. I think that great iconographers like Angelos Akotandos, or Andreas Ridzos, or Theophanes the Cretan, of course, they were free to experiment and use their artistic skills in ways that often surprised themselves as well. We have examples in Mountain Athos where Theophanes the Cretan used very naturalistic elements in his paintings. So that's true. There are some details, some landscapes that are some naturalistic in the way he has painted them. There are always exceptions, and there are always you can really contain these great masters. The thing is that they were not dry. That is what my point is. They were not dry. They were amazing painters, and if you are an amazing painter, you cannot just be contained into specific formulas in the way you paint. You want to experiment and try new things. Again, I don't mean to experiment with the form. Or if you experiment with form, you have to be really amazing in your drawing skills should be amazing. I've seen experimentations on the form, on the shapes. Many contemporary iconographers who bring the so-called new in iconography, as if iconography was in need of a new air. I've seen many iconographers whose work is of low quality, of low value. Of course, these iconographers, I'm sure they believe they are the new El Grecos or whatever, but that's another thing. I know that this is a very polemic discussion, and there will be people who have their opinions, of course, and that's fine. I'm open in everything, and I truly believe that there should be another opinion as well. To me, though, the way I approach art, I have to say this, is that in iconography, I try to be faithful and go deep in what I know in iconography, be faithful to this tradition, and not try to, let's say, enrich this tradition. This Byzantine painting is rich enough by itself. It doesn't need me to be more rich. The way opera doesn't need crazy new, let's say, remixes, doesn't need anything crazy about it. Opera is great, and we upload every contemporary, let's say, concert that is faithful to the actual partiture. If I want to experiment and express myself artistically, I feel free to move into a more naturalistic style, a more play and experiment with other styles that do not incorporate any Byzantine tradition. There, I truly feel free to express myself if I need to be, if I need this expression, and also, I believe that this informs my iconographic work. I feel that I become a better iconographer the more I paint, whatever it is that I paint. Oh my God, I really think that this might be confusing to many of you. If you follow me until now, this is great. And thank you all. You are really patient. Anyway, so yeah, just try to be to approach this tradition in a humble, nice way. This tradition existed before us, it will continue to exist, and if you think that you'll bring something new in it, then you have to think it twice. But you can bring something new into painting, into your studio with each and every icon that you paint, and that's really wonderful. So now that I've painted these psimthias using the way I describe in other videos, I was too busy in this video explaining my where I stand with iconography and painting in general. So if you want to know more about how I paint the psimthias, just feel free to check some other videos of mine, and I'm sure you'll find many where I explain this process very thoroughly. Now here I paint the I finished with my psimthias, and I will start painting my eyebrows and the beard. I'll do some mild corrections, always trying to give Saint Porfyrios a little bit of resemblance. At this point, I felt pretty confident that the icon would not be a disaster, and that my commissioner would be happy with the result. As you see in my channel, I often paint secular subjects, portraits of people, or I do studies of other painters of the past. And this is something that I would advise younger iconographers and more experienced ones to do often. To paint naturalistically in some other tradition, not the Byzantine one, this always, I feel that this has helped me become a better iconographer and to be a better painter in general. And of course, if I paint many portraits naturalistically, I don't feel the urge, the need to paint contemporary saints naturalistically. I will paint them in a very Byzantine style, and this need of mine will come out of my system if I paint my portraits and my still lifes and my landscapes. So feel free to experiment, and also experiment with new mediums. You can always try oil and or maybe acrylic or anything else, just to see how these other mediums behave and how different it is to blend two colors using egg tempera, and compare that to using oil colors. It's really amazing and so different. Now you see me now painting the beard of Saint Porfyrios, and this beard is very important in terms of this beard will give me much of the characteristic of the character of Saint Porfyrios. He had a very distinctive beard that was not very tamed, I would say, and this beard got thinner late in his life. I have to say that Saint Porfyrios is a very alive saint and very sweet. He was very sweet as a person. He loved Jesus above all, and he was a truly amazing person. If you don't know something about him, Google him, and I think his power will visit you just by searching him. Anyway, I paid a lot of attention when I drew his beard, because I felt that this beard would give me much of the character that I need for this icon. And when I painted it, I confirmed and that I was right from the beginning, and to draw this beard in a way that would resemble Saint Porfyrios. So when you have to paint a contemporary saint, just look at some of their photographs and try to see how you can translate it. Now, as you see here, I will not paint the beard of Saint Porfyrios in a realistic, naturalistic way. I will keep the shape of his beard, but I will paint on it in a very, let's say, hardcore, very traditional Cretan style. And that will give me an icon that is faithful to the Byzantine style, and also with some resemblance to Saint Porfyrios. So, draw correct shapes, but feel free to paint them in the Byzantine tradition. Now you see me painting the highlights of these first light shapes on the beard of Saint Porfyrios. This is a real time, you see me painting this in real time, like it's not a sped up video. I want to really thank you all for listening to me talking. I can tell that this is tiring for many of you, but that's why I want to tell you a big thank you for being here. We are almost 5,000 subscribers so far, and if you haven't yet, please consider subscribing. Press the like button for this video if you liked what you learned today. Feel free to comment and ask any questions. And I always like it so much when you even answer some of the questions that other iconographers ask. It's really sweet and moving how gentle and how generous you are in your comments. And I have to say that if you knew how this support of yours supports me, it would be nice. Thank you all so much, and I wish you are very creative, and you really take something out of these tutorials. This is my reward, and thank you so much. I plan to upload the course on some platform. It's going to be a many hour course. It's going to be a paid course at some point of how to paint a holy icon from scratch. I want to say that even though I will upload this course, I have to say to you that I don't withhold any information from the videos that I upload, and I try to explain the process as best as I can, or answer your questions as best as you can, as I can. So again, thank you for following me and for being part of this little community. Now, as you see, the beard is almost over. I painted the first layer of a beard using black, white, a little bit of the Proplasmos color, and a little bit of blue. Then I painted the highlights of the beard, and then I blended, let's say, with a very transparent color these highlights with the first layer of color. I am very pleased with this beard. The less it looks naturalistically, the better the better it is for me. And now I will paint this the holy face of Saint, the holy mouth of Saint Porfyrios, in a way that is painted in the Cretan Byzantine tradition. The face of Saint Porfyrios is almost over. I have to say that I am happy enough with the outcome of this icon. I believe that there is some resemblance there, and I'm pretty sure that my commissioner will be as happy as I am. Again, thank you all so much. Stay creative. Paint a lot, be in your studio a lot, be on your computers less, and I will see you soon with another video tutorial. Have a blessed week. Bye.